Welcome everybody to 52 Living Ideas. We are going through chapter 4 of the Bhagavad Gita. We're going to start by playing the recitation of Bhagavad Gita in Sanskrit for about 2 minutes to set the context. And then I'm going to have a couple of people read. We're going to start with Ambika, and then if Doug is there, or I'm going to take another volunteer. James, if you want to read, you're welcome to read. And then we are going to, we'll first read through the entire chapter, chapter 4, twice. And then I'm going to have about 3 or 4 people who are familiar with the chapter talk about what they get from the chapter. Then we will go through the chapter, you know, not verse by verse, but we're going to take a set of verses. It's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 sections. We will read each of them, and then we'll take questions and comments on each of them. That is the plan. So let me get started with playing
Imam Vivasvade Yogam Proktavana Havavayam Vivasvana Manave Praham Manurikshvatave Bravid Evam Parampara Praptam Imam Rajarshayo Viduhu Sakalene Hamahata Yogo Nashtav Parantapa Saevayam Mayatidya Yoga prokta puratanah aktosime sakha cheti rahasyam yetaduttamam Arjuna uvacha aparam bhavato janma paranyanma vivasvata katham etad vijaniyam tvamadau proktavaniti Sri Bhagavan uvacha Bahuni me vyati tani janmani tavacharjuna Tanyaham veda sarvani natvam vedha parantapa Ajopi sannavvayatma Bhutanam ishvaropi sann Prakritim swamadhishthaya sambhavam yatma mayaya Yada yada hi dharmasya jnanir bhavati bharata Abhyutthanam dharmasya tadatmanam srijamyaham paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha dushkritam dharma samsthapanarthaya sambhavami yuge yuge janma karma cha me divyam evayo veti tatvatah
All right, so let's have readings. We're going to start with Ambika. Ambika, if you could read the entire chapter.
The Blessed Lord said, I proclaimed this imperishable yoga to Vivasvan, the luminous sun god. Vivasvan declared it to Manu, the original man. Manu told it to Ishkvaku, the first of the solar descent. Thus obtained from one by another, the royal seers knew it. Then by great lapse of time, O Parantapa, Arjuna, that yoga was lost. That very ancient yoga is now declared to thee by me, for thou art my devotee and friend. This verily is the highest secret. Arjuna said, thine is a recent birth of this period. Far ancient was the birth of Vivasvan. How am I to understand that thou art the one who proclaimed this yoga in the beginning? The Blessed Lord said, many have been my lives in the past, and thine also, O Arjuna. All of them I know, but thou knowest them not, O Parantapa. Though I am the unborn, the imperishable self, though I am too the Lord of all existences, yet standing upon and presiding over my own nature, I come into being by myself, Maya. Whensoever, O Bharata, there is the fading and crisis of the Dharma and the uprising of unrighteousness, Adharma, then I lose myself forth into birth. For the deliverance of the good and the virtuous, for the destruction of the evildoers, for the enthroning of the right, Dharma, I am born from age to age. He who knoweth thus essentially, in its true principles, my divine birth and my divine work, comes not to rebirth after abandoning his body, he comes to me, O Arjuna, delivered from liking and fear and wrath, full of me, taking refuge in me, many purified by austerity of knowledge have arrived at my nature of being. As men approach me, so I accept them to my love. Men follow in every way my path, O Partha. Longing for the fulfillment of their works, men in the world offer their sacrifices to gods, various forms and personalities of the one Godhead. Quick and easy indeed is the fulfillment, Siddhi, born of works in the human world. The fourfold order, Chaturvarnya, according to the divisions of quality and active function, is created by me. Know me, the immutable non-doer, and yet the doer of it as well. Works affect me not, nor have I desire for the fruit of works. He who thus knows me is not bound by his works. So knowing was work done by the men of old who sought liberation, do therefore thou also work of that more ancient kind done by ancient men. What is karma? Action. And what is akarma? Inaction. As to this, even the sages are perplexed. I will declare to thee that karma, but by knowing which thou shalt be released from all ills. I will declare to thee that karma, by knowing which thou shalt be released from all ills. The principle of karma, action, is to be understood. The principle of vikarma, wrong action, also is to be understood. To be understood as well is the principle of akarma, inaction. Thick and tangled is the way of works. He also in action should be able to see inaction and action in inaction. He amongst men is the wise man of discernment. He, while doing all works, is in yoga. One whose inceptions and undertakings are all free from the motive of desire, whose works are burned up by the fire of knowledge, him the wise have called a sage. Having abandoned all attachment to the fruit of works, ever satisfied, without any dependence, even though well engaged in works, he in fact does nothing whatsoever. Above hope and expectation, controlled in heart and soul, having given up all sense of possession, doing simply physical actions, he begets no stain or sin. He who is satisfied with whatever gain comes to him and is beyond all dualities, free from jealousy and equal in success and failure, he is not bound even though he acts. One who is free from attachment, who is liberated, whose consciousness is established in self-knowledge, who performs works for sacrifice, all his action is dissolved. Brahman is the giving. Brahman is the food offering. By Brahman is it offered into the Brahman fire. Brahman verily is that which is to be attained by one in samadhi of Brahman action. Some other yogins follow after the sacrifice, which is for the gods. Others offer the sacrifice by the sacrifice itself into the Brahman fire. Others offer their senses, like hearing, etc., into the fires of control. Still others offer the objects of senses, sound and the like, into the fires of sense. And others offer all the actions of the sense and all the actions of the vital force into the fire of the yoga of self-control, kindled by knowledge. Similarly, others are the sacrificers of their material goods, some others of their austere energy, and yet others of their yoga, some strivers with keen and effective vows sacrifice their study and knowledge, and the others devoted to pranayama, breath control, having restrained the movements of prana and apan, incoming and outcoming breath, put as oblation the prana in apana, and likewise the apana in the prana. Still others, who are regulated and controlled in their diet, make an oblation of breath into breath. All these are knowers of sacrifice, cleansed of their impurities by yajna. They who enjoy the nectar of immortality, left over from the sacrifice, attain to the eternal Brahman. This world is not for him who doeth not sacrifice. How then any other world, O best of the Kurus, Arjuna? Thus the various forms of sacrifice are all extended in the mouth of Brahman, the mouth of that fire which receives all offerings. Know them all as born of karma, so knowing thou shalt become free. The sacrifice of knowledge, O Parantap, is superior to material sacrifice. All work in its totality, O Partha, finds its culmination and completeness in knowledge. Obtain that knowledge by prostrating at the feet of those who are in possession of it, the seers of essential principles, by inquiring and by service. They will initiate thee in that knowledge. Having that knowledge, thou shalt not return into delusion at all, O Pandava. By that, thou shalt see all existences without exception in the self, then in me. Even if thou art the greatest doer of sin beyond all sinners, thou shalt cross over all the crookedness of evil in the ship of knowledge. As a fire kindled turns to ashes its fuel, so too, O Arjuna, the fire of knowledge turns all works to ashes. There is nothing in the world to compare with knowledge in purity. The man who is perfected by yoga finds it of himself in the self by the course of time. The man of faith, with control over mind and senses, his heart and soul in that, attains to knowledge. Having attained knowledge, he at once obtains supreme peace. The ignorant who has not faith, the soul of doubt goeth to perdition, whether neither this world nor the supreme world nor any happiness is for the soul full of doubts. One who has torn all doubt by knowledge, O Dhananjay, and by yoga has given up all works, who is possessed of the self, him the works do not bind. Therefore, having cut asunder with the sword of knowledge this doubt, born of ignorance, lingering in the heart, stay in yoga, arise, O Bharata. Om Tat Sat.
Thank you, Ambika. That was beautiful reading. Really appreciate that. So folks, what we're going to do next is we're going to have a couple of people talk about their overview of this chapter, what the chapter is doing. And then we're going to go through the chapter part by part. So we're going to start with Yogeshwar, followed by James. Yogeshwar, go ahead, sir.
Hi. Mostly this chapter shows the first part for the first five shlokas. Mainly it talks about how Krishna Bhagavan has gotten this. Yeah, it talks about the parampara. Now in Hindu philosophy, always, whether it's any Puran or any Upanishad or even Gita, the parampara is like how this knowledge is gotten is really important. And whether it is Vyas who wrote Mahabharata, whether he is saying it or any other rishis in India, they always talk about how I got this, how whether it has been said before, who has said it before. So that is really important in Indian philosophy, that I am not making this up. It is not only my experience, but it is a collective experience. So many people have experienced this before me. And that is what I am telling you now. After that, mainly it is Krishna is talking about, I have actually, I've just gone out of words.
You can use Hindi words if you want, I can translate.
Okay, I've actually had an avatar before, like I've been reborn. Mainly, here rebirth of Krishna is mainly not, probably it's not like rebirth, but I have been, he knows about the Atman, he knows about Brahma, so he knows I am not this body. I am not this, the senses that I have got here. I am not the mind. So I am eternal, that he knows. So he's talking about his eternity to Arjuna. This eternity he has experienced, not that somebody has told him and he knows it. Right now, even I myself, like I know eternity by somebody telling me that the soul is eternal. But the way Krishna knows it is he knows it, he has experienced it, and he knows his previous when he was there previously. And in Yoga Shastra, in Yoga Sutra, there is a Bhashya of Vachaspatyam. He talks about the way to go into your deep sleep, into your dreams, and know your previous lives. So it is a way of knowing your previous lives in yoga. I have not tried it really, but I've only read about it. So I can only talk about it, but not out of experience. So according to this, Krishna actually knows his previous lives. He knows when he was there, when he knows like how this jnana has come to come on this earth. And it has been there from before. And then he talks about the karma yoga. Karma here, it's like where he talks about kim karma, kim akarmeti. What is karma and what is akarma? There even the most knowledgeable person, even the one who has the most intellect in the world, it is a really big thing for him to know. And after knowing that, what karma and akarma is, you're just in another sthiti. It's just another level of knowing. So you should know karma, you should know vikarma, and you should know akarma. Those are three main things. And a person who knows that where there is karma, like even in karma, there is akarma, and even in akarma, there is karma. It is those concepts really whereby a person who is seated and maybe he's just doing nothing, even him, he is doing some karma. Well, in normally, when we talk about a person who is just seated at home, we say he's just at home. He's doing nothing. That's what we say. But here it is like he is doing something. You should know that. The mind is always working. And even him, he's eating, he's drinking. So he's doing all that karma. And a person who is doing karma, this nishkam karma, karma whereby it is not all the nishkam karma, maybe you could say that. So he's doing all the karma. He's eating, he's drinking, he's actually going to work, he's contributing to the society, he's contributing to the world. Still, that karma is not onto him. Even though he's karmanya bipravritopi naiva kinchit karoti sa. So even though he is doing karma, he is not doing anything. That is a concept, like wrapping your mind around it, it's really difficult unless you've known something like you can actually do it, whereby you're doing the karma and you know that I am not doing the karma, whereby I am something inside. I am the seer of the mind. I am the seer of the body, and the body is doing the karma, and I am the seer seated behind, just watching the body doing the karma. So it's really important if we can know it in practice rather than just the words. And then Krishna goes on to talk about the yajnas, the different types of yajnas that are done in Indian philosophy. Even then, there were so many types of yajnas. There are so many different ways of getting to the goal. According to the different types of people, they will all do different things. Some will actually do dravya yajna, that is actually doing the yajna whereby there is ghee and there is wood and there is fire, and then you're putting in the fire. And even that, in a way, whereby he has shown that brahmarpanam brahmahavir, even in that, whereby there is a dravya yajna, still there is an essence of Brahma, whereby Brahma is the one who is giving in to Brahma, which is the fire, and giving what? Giving Brahma to Brahma. And then Brahmaiva tena gantavyam. Even the goal to give, to be gotten, is Brahma. And this actually, in some translations, and in some translations I've seen that they put this into the, when we're eating, yeah? They use this shlok when they're actually going to eat. They say the shlok before they're going to eat. And what it means in that perspective is, I am giving this food. This food is Brahma. And I am going to give, I, who is Brahma, is going to give this Brahma, this food, which is Brahma, into Brahma. Yeah, and the Agni they say is in the stomach there. Yeah, so I'm going to give it to Brahma, and then it is going to go to Brahma, and I am in Brahma right now. Brahma karma samadhina. I am seated in Brahma. So that's really a good way of looking at it, even. And then others, it is to control the senses and then controlling the prana and different types of yajnas, actually. You can take a whole good hour talking about the different types of yajnas. So actually, I will just end it here.
Yeah. Sure. Wonderful, Yogeshwar. This was just amazing. Thank you. Thank you so much. Very, very profound. What we have done is we've covered up to a point here, I think up to 32, and then 33 to 30, 42. Maybe we will get to it today, but maybe we'll not get to it because it is a very deep part added to that on Jnana Yoga. Okay. But Yogeshwar, thank you. Thank you so much. This was wonderful. James, would you like to talk about what you get from this chapter?
Okay. I didn't come to this having my thoughts organized, so this may be a bit disorganized.
That's all right, James. The fact that you've been studying this for 30 years, you're welcome. What we do here is that we are all speaking, we are all students. Mm-hmm. We are all trying to learn, and we are learning by speaking out what we understand, and all of us are sharing what we know. So please go ahead.
Thank you, Yogeshwar, for your remarks. I was at the Vedanta Center. We actually recite verse 24 before meals. Mm-hmm. I have several translations. The one I'm using here is by Eknath Ishwaran. South India. And just thinking about chapter four, I like the way it begins, you know, the back and forth. It's kind of interesting to put ourselves in that chariot and see the interaction between Arjuna and Krishna, who I get the impression sometimes Arjuna recognizes that Krishna is an avatar, the Supreme Lord, but at other times he seems not to. And that's an interesting perspective. But to my mind, perhaps one of the most profound verses in the entire 18 chapters is verse 7, whenever Dharma declines and the purpose of life is forgotten, I manifest myself on earth. I am born into every age to protect the good, to destroy evil, and to reestablish Dharma. Something we might talk about today or in a subsequent, I have different translations, and some of them speak of Krishna coming into the world and time periodically to protect good people and to destroy evil people. This translation and a few others that I have talk about protecting good. And one translation I have actually says, and to destroy the evil in men. In other words, he is not destroying evil men. He's destroying the evil in men. The idea that all suffering is remedial suffering, that we are better for our confrontation with the Lord. Unfortunately, I do not speak or read Sanskrit, so I don't know what the original says. It's one of the reasons I have so many translations that I look to. I figure that people who know this language, it's kind of like binocular vision. I can see it from a couple different perspectives. One other profound item in this chapter is in verse 11, as men approach me, so I receive them. There are religions in the world today in which God is presented as someone who presents a very narrow path, and if you miss it, you've missed it. And it is a very comforting and profound idea that as Krishna says later in the book, we are very dear to him, as dear as Arjuna is, I'm sure. And he is not setting an obstacle course whose goal is ultimately to separate us from him. And so that's one of the other things that just kind of burst through as I'm reading this chapter. What else? You know, the idea that as men approach me, so I receive them is kind of borne out in the rest of the chapter. He describes various ways that we can come to God. There are various aspects of sacrifice, various aspects, you know, the karma yoga, the dhyana yoga. Forgive my pronunciation if I'm butchering some of those words. But that ultimately, approaching someone who has realized the purpose of life, to approach a spiritual master, a guru, a wise man or woman, because it is difficult to get this from books. I'm here in the United States, and I don't know any gurus, nor would I recognize one, I don't think, if I saw one at my stage of progress. But there are people further along on this path than I am, and I have kind of apprenticed myself to them, and kind of doing the best I can. I think that's about all I have to say right now.
Thank you, James. That was wonderful. Thank you. So, folks, actually, this chapter covers a lot of area. So let us now go through it part by part. And now I'm going to, you know, we will read it out. James, could you start off by reading up to from 1 to 8? And then after you read it, then I'm going to open it up for anybody who wants to comment. So we're going to go through 1 to 8, and then 8 to 15, then 16 to 23, and 24 to 32. So the initial part is about the origin, about parampara or tradition that Yogeshwar talked about, and the idea of reincarnation, of why Krishna comes, why there is a reincarnation, why does he do that? Then from 9 to 15, or 9 to 23 is the part about karma yoga. And then from 24 to 32, there is a part about sacrifices, about yajna. The part from 33 to 42 is the beginning of what knowledge is. And that maybe we will not get to, because I want to make sure that when we do talk about it, we spend adequate time on it. So we'll go section by section, and we will go as far as we can go. We'll try to do justice as best as we can. So after the reading, anybody who wants is welcome to comment on what they get from that section. Initially, we're just talking about what do you get from the section. Try to stay close to the text. Then we will open it up for questions on the text. Then we'll go to the next one. And once we have finished the whole thing, we will open it up for general discussion. So in all these meetups, whether it is Tao Te Ching or Gospel of John or Bhagavad Gita, we try to stay close to the text in the first pass. That is to actually try to commune with the text and say, what is it saying? Instead of talking just about what comes to our mind and our own current thought. And once we have done that, then later on, we talk about our thoughts. So James, please go ahead. From 1 to 8.
Sri Krishna said, I told this eternal secret to Vivasvat. Vivasvat taught Manu, and Manu taught Ikshvaku. Thus, Arjuna, eminent sages received knowledge of yoga in a continuous tradition. But through time, the practice of yoga was lost in the world. The secret of these teachings is profound. I have explained them to you today because you are my friend and devotee. Arjuna said, "You were born much after Vivasvat. He lived very long ago. Why do you say that you taught this yoga in the beginning?" Shri Krishna said, "You and I have passed through many births, Arjuna. You have forgotten, but I remember them all. My true being is unborn and changeless. I am the Lord who dwells in every creature. Through the power of my own Maya, I manifest myself in a finite form. Whenever Dharma declines and the purpose of life is forgotten, I manifest myself on earth. I am born in every age to protect the good, to destroy evil, and to reestablish Dharma."
Thank you, James. So folks, now you're welcome to talk about what you get from this passage. We're going to start with Ash, followed by Claudio. Ash, go ahead.
Thanks, Srikant. For me, this specific set of verses, it ungrounds me a bit in the sense that it does give me a sense that this specific existence is temporary, and the specific desires and problems that are associated with this existence is also temporary. So I think it kind of ungrounds me with a sense of I would say a synonym of relief. It's not relief, but it's synonym of something like that.
Wonderful. Thank you, Ash. Next up is Claudio. Folks, if you would like to comment on this section, go ahead and type an exclamation mark or raise your hand in Zoom. Claudio, what do you get from this section?
Yes, I would like to just comment on verse number 5, where Krishna distinguishes himself in a way from Arjuna, because he's able to remember his past lives, right? It says, "The blessed Lord said, many are my lives that are past and thine also, O Arjuna. All of them I know, but thou knowest not," right? I guess Arjuna, because he's just an ordinary mortal, ordinary human being, he doesn't have that type of, he doesn't have the access to that type of knowledge. But we know that Krishna is no ordinary human being. He's the incarnation of Lord Vishnu, who is the supreme god of Hinduism, I believe. And he's been incarnated, I believe, 10 times in the form of avatars, and Krishna is one of them. So he's able to remember all his past lives. Now, I don't know whether Arjuna eventually will be able to remember his past lives if he be able through the practice of yoga. I'm not sure. But anyway, that's what I got from verse number 5. I found that very interesting. Thank you.
Thank you, Claudio. And folks, you are welcome, like Claudio did, to read out any verse in these verses. So we're going, you know, verse set by verse set. In that set, if there is some verse that speaks to you, just go ahead and read it out from the translation that you have when you're talking. Okay, you're welcome to do that. Next up is Evanique.
Yeah, the one thing that I got from those from verse 1-8 is that the Lord dwells in every creature. When he talks about that, and I just think about that, like the divine and human aspect of it. And so I really like how that theme just goes across all different types of religions, is that we are fully human and fully divine, and that he shows that. And I think Claudia already talked about the whole part about, that he remembers and Arjuna doesn't. And I think sometimes we forget our divinity too, so.
Beautiful. Thank you, Evanique. All right. If there is anybody else, go ahead and type exclamation mark. Otherwise, we're going to go from 9 to 15. Ambika, go ahead.
Sorry about that. So it's a lovely idea. And you know, we find it again and again, Krishna saying, I can see all my past lives. And it made me wonder with the time, all times exist at one time. So it's not necessarily maybe looking back, but seeing all of creation and all times, all spaces as one, even though for us there is a shift from one to the other. In this case, it's all one. And then what was the other thing? It's very heartening and assuring to know that for deliverance of the good and the virtuous, Krishna shows up, and we need that in these times very much. So I'm feeling much more assured now. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambika. And let's keep to the text. Thank you. Ambika, if you could go ahead and read the next section from 9 to 15.
He who knoweth thus essentially in its true principles, my divine birth and my divine work, comes not to rebirth after abandoning his body. He comes to me, O Arjuna. Delivered from liking and fear and wrath, full of me, taking refuge in me, many purified by austerity of knowledge have arrived at my nature of being. As men approach me, so I accept them to my love. Men follow in every way my path, O Partha. Longing for the fulfillment of their works, men in the world offer their sacrifices to gods, various forms and personalities of the one Godhead. Quick and easy indeed is the fulfillment, Siddhi, born of works in the human world. The fourfold order, Chaturvarnya, according to the divisions of quality and active function, is created by me. Know me, the immutable non-doer, and yet the doer of it as well. Works affect me not, nor have I desire for the fruit of works. He who thus knows me is not bound by his works. So knowing was work done by the men of old who sought liberation. Do therefore thou also work of that more ancient kind done by ancient men. 16 as well?
No, that's good. Thank you. Thank you. Folks, if you have any comments about any of these, or if there is a verse that really speaks to you, please go ahead and type exclamation mark or raise your hand in Zoom. Yogeshwar, go ahead.
Talking about karma doesn't actually, Krishna is saying this, that namam karmani limpanti name karma phalespriha. So even in the fruits of the karma, I don't really need the fruits, but still I do karma. Yeah. And if somebody knows that I am like this, he also won't be bound by karma. He won't be also bound by his activities. So even the knowing, just the knowing, it actually triggers something, because knowing this is not a simple thing, because knowing is not just reciting or just knowing by your knowledge or something. But if you practice something like that, you can know that somebody like Krishna can be even more profound than me. If I have reached this stage by doing some activity or by doing some yoga or knowing something, then Krishna has actually attained a stage farther than me. Like if I've walked the road 2 meters, I can see that the road is still there's still much road still remaining ahead. But if I've not even walked the road, I won't know that there's a road. And then whereby he says that Chaturvarnam Maya Srishtam, the four varnas are created by me. Guna Karma Vibhagasha. Now here, this is a very sensitive thing to talk about. The char varna, the four varnas in Hinduism, it is actually not the way it is supposed to be right now, but how Krishna has said it, guna, karma, vibhagasha. How the distribution is made is by guna and by karma. Now you see how, whereby there is Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, and Shudra. So all of them have their separate karma to do. And they keep on passing on that karma to their children. And that's how it has been since. Yeah? So why that has been, there's also about, if I could talk something about science genetics.
Yogeshwar, can I add one thing? I just want to make sure that people understand guna and karma. So can you talk a little bit about what guna means?
Yes, guna. Now guna, three types of guna. Yeah, that is sattva, raja, and tama. So raja mainly, it's what makes you do all the activities. It's what makes you do any activity. Yeah, and tama is the one that stops you from activity. So that will be pramad or sleep, yeah? Mm-hmm. And sattva is the, sattva mainly is love and shanti, and that is sattva mainly. So even by those categories, the four varnas are made.
Thank you, please go on.
Yeah. So a concept of genetics, just want to touch on it and then I'll come back to this. You see how genetics affects the child. So the father and the mother have some type of genes and those genes come into the child. So in Hindu philosophy, the Atman who is going to come to the mother in the womb chooses which womb I will go to, yeah? That is in the Hindu philosophy. So he would choose the womb whereby his type of karma, yeah, would be fitting in. So so how the genetics affects, like if I am the Atman who has not yet been, who has to become a human being, or even in animals, yeah? Animals, even in plants, the same concept. So the Atman chooses the womb and it will be by how the mother and father have this new creation inside the womb. And the genetics actually affects which new Atman will come in. So according to that, like if I am like, before, not, I'm not talking about now, yeah? Talking about how it was created. So how it was created, the science behind it is that if I am, like maybe I say I'm a soldier, yeah? And those genetics are passed down to my child. So that is how I will also teach my child to be a soldier. Why? Because I know he has those genetics, he has those qualities and all those, like strength maybe, or the mind that will that a soldier would use, and all those are passed through genetics. So that I can teach my child, and that will be an added benefit. The genetics would be an added benefit to the teachings that I will give.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Yogeshwar.
But,
Go ahead.
Right now, it will not really it would not really be profound to actually stick only by that and say, oh, I'm a Brahmin and I will only marry a Brahmin, or I'll only do this and I'll not do any other thing. So right now it's another type, but when it was done, like when all the rishis had come up with this idea, it was that.
Wonderful. Yogeshwar, thank you very much for this, because I mean, this is a very delicate point, because what happens is that it takes a lot to understand something, a system of thought, a system of society that was done at another time. And what Yogeshwar has just done is actually quite remarkable, because what he did was that he said, okay, what was the basis? What was the thinking behind this? Because what happens is that no matter what religion does, it gets converted into rituals. And the way in which it is implemented is actually quite different from the original intent. So the original intent here is twofold. You know, I'm trying to summarize. I can't do justice to summarizing what he said, but I will highlight two points. One point is the Indian notion of reincarnation, that it is the soul which is coming into life multiple times. And the point that Yogeshwar is making is that the soul chooses a particular form of life, particular place in society. So there is that one idea. The second idea, it is as per guna and karma. So it is about characteristics, your own character, and the work. So those are the two points that I want to highlight, because it is very easy, you know, and again, all the systems get kind of ossified into very rigid hierarchies, and those are considered as the thing that was being promoted, but which is not the case. We've seen this again and again in all the three works. So I just want to, you know, I want to thank Yogeshwar for bringing up this delicate point and showing the background for it. Next up is going to be Ash, followed by Elena. Ash, what did you get from this section? Ash, if you could unmute.
Yeah, sorry, I'm here. I'm having trouble unmuting. Okay, so for me, I think the specific verse which says, number 11, which says, as they approach me, so I receive them. For me, if I were to take not so much a godly stance, but a human stance, I think that is a very, that's a great line for good interpersonal relationships, really. So it is very non-judgmental, and it is just accepting people as they are. So as they come to me, shall I receive them? It's very simple.
Yes, excellent point. I also like that verse a lot. And I was looking at the parallels between this and what we discussed in Gospel of John just yesterday. So my Marathi translation of it, of 11, says, Je lok mala ja prakarane bhastat, tyans tasats mi bhasto. So the way in which they love me, I love them. So there is this loop between God loves man and man loves God. So it is, you know, God so loved the world, and the whole purpose of that was to create love of God within people. So there is that two-way loop of love, and which is there here, and which is there in the Bible as well. So thank you, Ash. Next up is going to be Ash. Go ahead.
Yeah, is there a time for a question or is that later?
We will do the questions later, but you know what? Your questions are very good. So go ahead and put a question on the table. We're not going to answer it, but it's good to have questions, planted in the minds of people. So go ahead and plant it now.
Yeah, so the question really is, for me, again, on verse 12, it says those desiring success in their actions worship the gods, and through action in the world of mortals, their desires are quickly fulfilled. So I'd like to believe that, it's actually a question. So I'd like to believe that this specific text was not so much written from a religious point of view at all in its outset. So I kind of feel that the word gods in here means probably something else as we really understand it. So I'm kind of keen to get some perspective on someone saying, what is the intent of the word God here?
Thank you, Ash. So I'm just going to put it as, instead of kind of specifying it that way, I'm going to put it as, what does verse 12 mean? Put that as an open-ended question whenever we can get to it. Next up is going to be Elena. Elena, what do you think of these verses? And if there is a favorite verse that you have, you're welcome to share it. Elena, you need to unmute. Okay, next up is going to be Bhagavad.
I unmuted myself.
Go ahead.
Okay. All right, took me a while. Thank you. So one of my favorite verses here actually was the 4.12, the mm-hmm. same thing that Ash just brought up. We still live in this material world, right? In this world, those desiring success in material activities worship the celestial gods, since the material rewards manifest quickly. And if we're going to discuss it later, then I'm not going to dwell on it. And I'm just going to bring up another point that just was striking.
Go ahead.
So what Krishna says, that he's the creator of this system. So he's just admits that he was the one who designed and created the system. And then he continues and he speaks about, say, doing action and not being tainted by actions, and neither often being affected by an action. And then he continues further. But that's something that to me just kind of resonated about that. And further, I'd like to also, if someone knows more about it, would discuss that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Elena. Next up is going to be Bharadwaj, followed by Madeline. Bharadwaj.
Hi, are you able to hear me?
Yes.
So I was thinking about the verse number 11 here myself. I'm going to quickly read the translation that I have, which reads, he who knows the nature of my task and my holy birth is not reborn. When he leaves his body, he comes to me. So I was trying to understand if me or Krishna kind of referring to himself, is it the God Krishna or is it something else? And I like Ash's kind of interpretation there. When I'm trying to understand this, I try to relate the word, Atma and Brahman sometimes to consciousness. And I could be wrong there. I don't understand those terms fully. And I was trying to place that understanding over here as maybe Krishna is, when Krishna says himself, maybe he's talking about, when one realizes that they are consciousness, that maybe they are kind of relieved from troubles and pains. I don't know if that's what's maybe being conveyed here, but maybe someone else can resolve this for me. But I feel like there's maybe some interpretation there. I'd like someone's thoughts on that.
Wonderful. This is verse number 9, right?
Is it? It could be. I could be wrong then.
Yes. So what we will do is that we will discuss that. We'll discuss verse number once everybody has had a chance to comment. We would discuss number 12 and then number 9. So let's go with Madeline, Jyoti, and Joe. Madeline.
Yes. Thank you, Shrikant. I'm afraid I don't have the text in front of me this evening. I believe there was a line that went something like, desires reach their fulfillment quickly in the human mind. And I was wondering if what was meant by that is in our own heads, our desires reach fulfillment, our imagination takes us there. But that's very different from how it happens in the world or not necessarily in sync. Is that what that passage means?
Okay, wonderful. Now, this is the third person who has brought up number 12. So let us just take a pause and let's look at number 12. Okay, so anybody who's familiar with 12, if you could now forget about all the questions, let's just read 12 and anybody who's familiar with 12 can explain what it means. Yogeshwar or James, I invite you to do that. Yogeshwar, would you like to talk about number 12 and what it means? If you could read it out in Sanskrit. Yogeshwar, you need to unmute. Okay, let's go with James. James, can you read number 12 and talk about what it means?
Okay, and I can't read it in Sanskrit, but
okay.
Those desiring success in their actions worship the gods. Through action in the world of mortals, their desires are quickly fulfilled. I think it's at least possible that both halves of this verse are only tangentially related to one another. It seems that Krishna is saying that one can direct one's spiritual activity towards something less lofty than the ultimate, but he doesn't seem to criticize that there are, just as there are different ways to approach God, there are different aspects through which, you know, within a Western tradition, I think of in Dante Alighieri's Divine Comedy, in paradise, there are different levels. In the old way of conceiving the universe, there were, you know, spheres of the planets, and everyone is at a different one. And I sometimes make that connection here. I don't know if that's just my own thinking on the subject, but that we can point our efforts toward different spiritual goals. But the second half of the verse doesn't say that it is the gods or perhaps the demigods that reward us with fulfilling our desires, but just a bare statement that through action in this world, the desires of mortals are quickly fulfilled, that we have that power, we have that capability, and it is a legitimate, if not an ultimate, goal within the spiritual quest.
Wonderful, thank you. Anybody else wants to talk about what they get from this verse is welcome to do that. Go ahead and type a exclamation mark. The way I see it, the way I understand it, again, my understanding is not very good. They who desire the fulfillment of their works on earth sacrifice to the gods. So one thing that it is saying is that you have to sacrifice. If you actually want your work to succeed, you have to sacrifice to the gods. What does that mean? That means you have to follow the right path. And if you do follow the right path, so it is arguing for following the right path, following the path that God has laid out for you doing the sacrifices. Because the fulfillment that is born of the works is very swift and easy in the human world. So I think it is arguing, may the best as I read it, is that it is arguing that if you do follow the right path, then your work will be successful. Next up is going to be David, followed by Dean. David.
Yes, thanks, Shri Krishna. Just a clarification. In the Sanskrit, what exactly is the word sacrifice? I mean, are we translating that correctly into English?
Absolutely. So that is a point that we are going to come to when we go to, there is an entire section from 24 to 32, and we will deal with that over there, because that is the entire, that entire section is about just that concept.
Great, thank you.
Next up is going to be, let's see.
Dean.
Go ahead, Dean.
Yeah, so Shrikant, I just have a question regarding this verse you've just read. As I said, I only have read the two chapters, but my understanding at the beginning of the Bhagavad Gita, so Arjuna is in a state of inaction, right? He's torn between going to fight his own like family and you know, teachers and all of this, and then between taking action. So the sentence you just mentioned, I think it kind of reinforces to that first conversation where he had to do a wrong, like he had to move from inaction to action. At the same time, it tells him like you have to trust, like it's kind of like what God or destiny has put on your path and stick to it. You will have to do a sacrifice in the term of like you might have to, in this case, he's fighting his own kin, but you have to get the reward but if you pursue on the path, you will get the reward that you deserve. That's what I kind of make sense of it.
Thank you, Dean. Ambika, followed by Ash. Ambika, what do you get from number 12?
I like what Dean said, and I'd add that to do your duty as you're required to do, and to not be attached to the result, whether it's good or bad, but know that whatever accomplishment comes from that is, even though it's yours, you don't want to be attached to it, because the actions that you did were also influenced by that, which is the Atman, the soul, and that is the all-pervading essence. So all of you is all of this, and so not to be attached to the duty of it. And the siddhis are very, very special skills that people develop. And we don't necessarily have some of them, but you know, siddhas, again, it's a whole different tradition, which we won't get into now, but to be enjoying of the action of doing rather than what you get out of it. And that should be the fulfillment and satisfaction.
Thank you. One thing I would add is that this is about karma. This is a point about karma. And I see this as a part of the entire constellation of points that are being made about karma. So instead of trying to understand it by itself, I would put it side by side with everything that he's saying about karma. Next up is going to be Ash, followed by Joe. Ash.
Thanks, Shrikant. So when I read it again, so the way it's written in the translation that I have is those desiring success in their actions worship the gods. It's a semicolon after that, and it says, worship the gods through action in the world of mortals. Their desires are quickly fulfilled. So I'm kind of trending towards two interpretations here. So when I read it all together, it just says, those desiring success in their actions worship the gods through action in the world of mortals. So it's more like you said, Shrikant, it feels like the worship is happening through action. And again, the more I read about it, the way I'm interpreting the word gods is some kind of excellence. So you know, when you say those desiring success in their actions worship the gods through action in through action. So fundamentally, if you want to achieve a certain sense of excellence, you are putting in action in a certain way. And that certain way is possibly through dedication, grit, resilience, passion, and the positive energies that go along with it.
Thank you. Thank you, Ash. Next up is Joe.
Yeah, just briefly, this idea of, you know, worshiping through action, and then combining that with what Ambika said is the idea of not being tied to the outcome, kind of relates back to number 10 to me a little bit, because I also, that's freedom from passions and freedom from your desires. So that's kind of the three are interrelated, I would say, is that if you free yourself of your desires and your passions, that they're no longer tied to the outcome and your actions are pure in nature. So that's 10 and 12, I'm kind of seeing some kind of,
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you. I mean, the point that is coming out, this is basically virtue ethic of saying, you know, do the right thing, regardless of what the emotions you're feeling, regardless of what the results are. And if you follow the virtue, if you act according to, it will actually succeed. Oh, that's what it is saying, as best as I understand it. Next up is going to be Ambika. Ambika, go ahead.
Except for the desire to do more prayers, you know, you're going, you want to give in to that desire. And it goes back to that shloka, Brahmarpanam Brahmahavid Brahmagno Brahmanahutam Brahmavatena Dantavyam Brahmakarma Samadhina. Everything is Brahma, what you give into, the action you give, putting into Brahma, because it is this whole cosmos into which you are doing this dance and with which.
Wonderful. Thank you. All right, let's continue. Jyoti, you had a comment. Now you can make a comment about this entire section. Jyoti, go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to make a comment about number 10. It is a little different in the book that I have been reading. Being freed from the attachment, fear and anger, being fully absorbed in me and taking refuge in me, many, many persons in the past became purified by knowledge of me. And thus they all attained transcendental love for me. So what he's saying in this verse is that many people who are embedded in materialism do not understand that I am and the absolute truth. I am a person, I was a person. And I can fulfill your desires, but they have difficulty understanding that because they are too consumed in materialism. They cannot even fathom that the Lord Krishna was imperishable. And he's the one who has all the knowledge. So this is what I am getting from my book.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Jyoti. What I'm going to do is that I'm going to read out a very short comment by Sri Aurobindo about the divine worker. He calls it the divine worker. He says, to attain to the divine birth, a divinizing new birth of soul into a higher consciousness, and to do divine works, both as a means towards that before it is attained, and as an expression of it after it is attained, is then all the karma yoga of Gita. Let me read that again. To attain to the divine birth, a divinizing new birth of a soul into a higher consciousness, and to do divine works for two reasons, both as a means towards that before it is attained, and as an expression of it after it is attained, is then all the karma yoga of the Gita. The Gita does not try to define works by any outward signs through which they can be recognizable to an external gaze, measurable by the criticism of the world. it deliberately renounces even the ordinary ethical distinctions by which men seek to guide themselves in the light of human reason. The signs by which it distinguishes divine works are all profoundly intimate and subjective. The stamp by which they are known is invisible, spiritual, supraethical. They are recognizable only by the light of the soul from which they come. Okay, so we're going to now go to the next sections, which are going to be from 16 through 23. Ambika, could you go ahead and read from 16 to 23?
What is karma, action, and what is akarma, inaction? As to this, even the sages are perplexed. I will declare to thee that karma, by knowing which thou shalt be released from all ills. The principle of karma, action, is to be understood. The principle of vikarma, wrong action, also is to be understood. To be understood as well is the principle of akarma, inaction. Thick and tangled is the way of works. He who in action should be able to see inaction and action in inaction, he amongst men is the wise man of discernment. He, while doing all works, is in yoga. One whose inceptions and undertakings are all free from the motive of desire, whose works are burned up by the fire of knowledge, him the wise have called a sage. Having abandoned all attachment to the fruit of works, ever satisfied without any dependence, even though well engaged in works, he in fact does nothing whatsoever. Above hope and expectation, controlled in heart and soul, having given up all sense of possession, doing simply physical actions, he begets no stain or sin. He who is satisfied with whatever gain comes to him and is beyond all dualities, free from jealousy and equal in success and failure, he is not bound even though he acts. One who is free from attachment, who is liberated, whose consciousness is established in self-knowledge, who performs works for sacrifice, all his action is dissolved.
Thank you, Ambika. So now the floor is open for anybody who wants to talk about what they get from this section. You're also welcome to read out any particular verse that speaks to you. You're also welcome to put a question on the table. And what we will do is that we will take all the questions, answering the questions at the end of this section. Allison, go ahead.
I was really struck by, that's 18, where it says he, or in my version, it says he who can see inaction in the midst of action and action in the midst of inaction is wise and can see, it can act in the spirit of yoga. What I was thinking of that is that when you're doing something, that's action, but there's like a stillness in your mind. So that's inaction, but also the reverse is also true, that when you're very still, your mind is still going. And so that's both action and inaction at the same time. And I thought that that counterbalance between these two opposing ideas was really captivating to me. Also in the stanza above it, when they talked about wrong action and inaction, I thought that was really interesting because an inaction is very different from a wrong action. So that was just something that struck me that I was curious about.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Allison. And this point about action and inaction is a profound point. because he describes, you know, Krishna is describing himself as saying that I don't act and I act at the same time. It's a question of the center, you know, the center, which is stable. And there is this entire world of action that is going on. So you can see yourself as being participating in that action at the same time, a part of you, the core of you is not moving. So it's the immovable mover kind of a principle.
It also echoes that they're in the middle of a war and then they have this stillness in the middle where they're having this conversation.
Very good. And the war is simply a metaphor for the world itself. So the world is going like that. Yeah. He's talking about the world itself as and there being a essence that remains constant. Next up is going to be Joe.
Just building on this idea of inaction. It's, you know, I kind of see it as inexertion, like this, where you're totally centered in a state of almost flow. So I look at it as the same concept as Wu Wei in for the Tao. So that this is like, it's not necessarily not doing, it's actually effortless, that you're centered with and almost like water in nature. So that's how I view this form of inaction. It's an effortless action, but it doesn't mean necessarily inaction. And I don't know if that's what he's getting at, but that's
excellent point. I think it's the same kind of a concept. And Tao Te Ching talks about this in so many different verses. This idea of there being action and there being a center which is not moved, and there is this action. Wonderful. If anybody has any comments or any words that they would like to highlight, they're welcome to do that. Otherwise, we'll go to the next one. Ambika.
I just wondered about, you know, Sthit Pragna,
mm-hmm.
whether that quality of being, which we discussed, I mean, some weeks ago, is that sense of presence, but also the sense of holding that within without dissipating energies, and therefore that inaction action stays in that. And to me, I think this is also a quality of stoicism, to have that capacity to see the all, to know the all, and take action when it's needed, while observing is also an action where there's no movement, except there is movement, you know, this way. But you can still be like this as the sage who can see what's going on and therefore can see beyond the physical dimension.
Excellent point. I think the Sthita Pragna is the core, is also, it's pointing to exactly the same thing, that Sthita, it means you're standing. So there is a standing, and that's a constant wisdom, you know, constant intelligence that remains so in the midst of action. So you are taking action, you are observing things, you are acting. At the same time, there is a steady intelligence, the steady wisdom, a point from which you are acting, a point which is unaffected by the positives and the negatives that are flowing by, and that is constant in the process. Next up is going to be Jyoti and Ash. Jyoti.
Yeah, a person who's acting in Krishna consciousness, he's naturally free from the bonds of karma. His activities are all performed for Krishna, therefore he does not enjoy or suffer any of the effects of the work. And I think that says it all.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Jyoti. Next up is going to be Ash, followed by Dean. Ash.
Thank you, Srikant. So I think on number 17, it states that the true nature of action is difficult to grasp, and you must understand what is the action, what is action, and what is an action, and what kind of action should be avoided. Now, what strikes me is in the subsequent paragraphs, there is enough content about what is action, which is fair enough, but it kind of doesn't talk about what inaction is. So for me, that's it's an observation. So it's a blank for me there. The second bit really is that in 23, it says they are free without selfish attachments. Their minds are fixed in knowledge. They perform all work in the spirit of service and their karma is dissolved. Now, what I understood in the previous part or section that we discussed is really around the path to excellence really is action. So there is a bit of a dichotomy for me here of action versus knowledge. And I don't know where to draw the line.
That's an excellent point. And we're going to be talking about that, you know, once we get into like 33 to 42. So the action is seen on one hand as worship. But once you are there, the worship kind of disappears and you are already there, something like that. That's the way I would put it, but it's not very clear. And but that's the general kind of, and we will come to that if we get to 33 to 42 today. Next up is going to be Dean.
Sorry, I'm still struggling. I wouldn't say struggling, but I'm still trying to digest the action and inaction. To make it simpler, so are we saying that you're kind of like grounded in a way, you know when to be in action and when to be in inaction, like basically how to manage your energy or how to manage the in a way that you're at your optimum, you're kind of like optimum at the situation. The other thing is like there was a mention of it's like you're doing it for God. So if you're managing your action, so what does, I forgot the sentence, but there was something about for the, you know, to do it for the God. Why would you do it for the God, not for yourself?
Sure. That's kind of a general questions. So quick answer to that is the way in which they are looking at inaction and action is like a whirlpool. Imagine a whirlpool where the water is moving, but there is a center. Or look at a galaxy with all its arms. They're whirling around, but there is a center which remains constant around which everything is moving. It's that kind of a thing. And the God is a short for saying the right way by following the virtue. And so that's what it is saying. When you're saying that follow the God, you're saying do the right thing. Follow the line of virtue in order to be, for your works to be effective. Next up is going to be Claudio. Claudio, go ahead.
Yes, verse 21, if I may read it. He has no personal hopes, does not seize on things as his personal possessions. His heart and self are under perfect control. Performing action by the body alone, he does not commit sin. So I guess he's alluding to the detachment here, not concerning yourself with the results of your actions. And I believe that's attained through yoga, and that's becoming one, I believe, with Krishna, because Krishna is the higher self, and he resides in everybody. So people who are attached to their actions, concerned with the fruits, the results, I believe they're to involve with their lower self, because only through the higher self can you retain detachment. So I believe it's done through yoga, becoming one with Krishna, the higher self, because the Gita does emphasize two different selves, the self with the capital S and the one with the lower S. Sorry. Thank you.
Thank you, Claudio. All right. So now we'll go to the next one. Doug. Welcome. Would you like to read something from, we're doing chapter 4 from 24 to 32. We're going section by section. And at the same time, you're welcome to talk about what you get from the entire chapter. Go ahead, Doug.
Well, I need to find my place because mine is not numbered.
Sure. It's number 24. Let me see here. It says, it's from the favorite. You know what? Let us spend time on 24. Okay. Let's see.
Let me catch up with you. I'll find where it is.
James, if you could read 24 and talk about, we'll just talk about that one for now. So if you could read that out and talk about what it means to you.
Okay. I'm going to switch translations to somebody from the Vedanta Society, Swami Nikhilananda. To him, Brahman is the offering, and Brahman is the oblation, and it is Brahman who offers the oblation in the fire of Brahman. Brahman alone is attained by him who thus sees Brahman in action. Boy, that's a puzzling verse, but it's it almost looks very self-referential in there, in the kind of way that logical self-reference ties you up in knots. As I mentioned earlier, we recite this verse at the Vedanta Center before meals. It's recited in Sanskrit, but I'm aware of the translation as we're doing it, so I can kind of follow along. I think it speaks to the universality of Brahman, that that while we see the world divided up into separate entities, there's you, there's me, there's, you know, all of the individuals, but that's an overlay on an underlying unity, that Brahman is the offering, Brahman is what is offered, Brahman is the entity to whom the offering is made, and that seeing that is in some sense the goal, just as seeing action in inaction. And it's not something that can be forced. I expect we've all had the experience of looking at not an optical illusion, but like those three-dimensional pictures, which you can see one way or another. And if you don't see it the other way, you just don't see it and you can't force it. It's something that has to be realized and not achieved, perhaps, if that distinction means anything. I don't know if any of those remarks are helpful, but.
Thank you. Thank you. Yogeshwar, I know you've said everything that you had to say, but if you could repeat that, because it is so profound that I want people to refocus on that. Could you repeat what you said about number 24?
Mainly, I've read different translations and different commentaries on this. So some say that this is Dravya Yajna, whereby the normal Yajna that we know for the Hindu society, whereby there is the fire in the middle, and then they put the wood and the ghee. So Brahmarpanam, Brahmahavir. So what the offering is, it is Brahma. The fire in the middle is Brahma. The person who is offering is Brahma, which is me. And what the person who is me has to get, the goal that I have to get, is Brahma. And I am right now seated in Brahma. I am sit in Brahma. I don't have a direct translation for sthita. So it's not actually seated, but sthita in Brahma. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then for the commentary whereby you're having a meal. Before the meal, you say this. So it is Brahma Arpanam Brahmavi. So the food is Brahma. I am Brahma. And the right now, the Jataragni, we call it in Sanskrit. And right now, we could refer it to as the hydrochloric acid. What in the stomach, what digests the food? It's a type of heat that digests the food. So the heat in the body, which is Agni, the fire in the body, so that is also Brahma. What the activities that I am going to do after this food is processed in my body and becomes one with my body, those activities are also Brahma. And even right now, I am Sthita in Brahma. So Brahma is actually here, what as it was said before, Brahma in the Indian concept, it's like we are all one. There is no I, you. So there the ahankar, which is the ego, it is not there. The ego of the self is not there actually. It is, we are all one, and I am going to do activity as Brahma, and it is going to contribute to the whole world. Whereby if there's like, if I can take a concept of whereby there's a pond and then you just do an activity of throwing a stone in it, but it will create a ripple effect. So all the activities I do will affect the whole world in the ripple effect.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Yogeshwar. Really appreciate that. Next up is going to be Joe, followed by Ambika. Folks, if you'd like to talk about number 24, please go ahead and type exclamation mark or raise your hand in Zoom. Joe.
Just really briefly, what I thought about something you said a little bit earlier about how religion gets converted into rituals and how James had talked about when he says this before each meal. And I think of this is a form of sacrifice and practice, like for you're having your meal, whether it be for the gods, whether it be for a food offering or for fire. All these things are done as far as an offering. That's the way I see this, as a form of sacrifice more than anything else.
Wonderful. Yesterday we were talking about the Eucharist, we were talking about the symbolism of ingesting the body of Christ in you. And this is very similar to that. That you are taking in Brahma, you are Brahma, you're taking that in, even the process of processing it is Brahma. So it is analogous to that. Next up is, let's go with Doug first. Doug, Madhav, David, and then Ambika. Doug.
I'm looking for the section here. Well, I'll read this section that I think includes the section you're talking about, but I think the context is also good in this translation. And this is the Swami Prabhavananda Christopher Isherwood translation. When the bonds are broken, his illumined heart beats in Brahman. His every action is worship of Brahman. Can such acts bring evil? Brahman is the ritual. Brahman is the offering. Brahman is he who offers to the fire that is Brahman. If a man sees Brahman in every action, he will find Brahman.
Wow, that is a beautiful, beautiful translation.
Yeah, it is. I think as Isherwood was a great writer in English, there's a rhythm he gets that is good. You know, what it means, this chapter, I kept reading it and it would make sense to me about halfway through, and then I would just jump off the rails. It was like the number of permutations. Although this point, actually, when I was just reading it now, it was reminding me of things that Whitman does in Song of Myself, you know, where he kind of identifies with everything and he kind of merges with the universe, and that it seems to be whatever acts, whatever moves, at some ultimate point is Brahman, and then the connection to that might be the Atman, but then there are other veils that sort of connect us or hide the Atman, maybe. And so the Atman is more associated, I have associated over the years, with the individual spark and light, and then that connects to a larger spark and light. And that this energy manifests in a different way in particularly difficult times. That was interesting to me in the chapter, that when things go awry, which oddly reminds me of Hamlet. Was Hamlet a kind of Krishna? I mean, he says the time, you know, the time is out of joint and cursed spite that I am born to set it right. And, you know, he's there and manifests because something is really wrong and he's got to take care of it, which he does actually. And he sacrifices himself in the doing of it. And so these sacrifices, they exist in all cultures. But beyond that, I couldn't join at the top because of a range of things that I've been dealing with, but I did want to join and hear what other people had to say about it, because of all the chapters we've read so far, this is the one that I sort of had a hold of and then suddenly it would slip out of my hands, you know.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Doug. Next up is going to be Madhav, David, and Ambika. Madhav.
So what I think this shloka is referring to when it talks about Brahman is the philosophy of Advaita Vedanta in Hinduism. And what Advaita Vedanta is the philosophy of non-duality. When we go through this world, we feel this duality between the subjective and the objective being the body and mind, and the objective being the whole world. And what it says that this line that we see is nothing but Maya. And this shloka is Brahman that we're offering to is Brahman. What we're offering to is Brahman. We are Brahman. What we're eating is Brahman. And everything is just this one non-dual reality. And one quote by Swami Vivekananda, who's one of the pillars for Advaita Vedanta, is Christ, Buddha, and Krishna are but waves in the ocean of infinite consciousness that I am. And I think that is that relates to this Brahman shloka.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Madhav. Next up is going to be David, followed by Ambika. David.
Yes, thanks, Shrikant. I mean, maybe I'm misunderstanding or reading too much into this, but it seems, I mean, that all of us are so drawn to these, what I've heard in Hinduism also is these Mahavakyas. I mean, it seems very related to that. Am I misunderstanding that this is sort of one of the essences of describing this basic unity of us and God? And so I mean, it seems that this is sort of a key, one verse that resonates or reflects those broader concepts that are throughout the entire Hindu
Absolutely.
Literature. Absolutely. So that's what I say. So I think that's, I mean, especially the Tattvamasi, I mean, that you know, with these Brahmins, that we are all part of this, that we are all, you and I, and that this is maybe a specific, you know, gives sort of specific examples or a subset of to try to resonate with people, the different aspects of life and humanity and people, that we are all tied together through these items mentioned in verse 24.
Thank you. Thank you, David. Absolutely. Next up is Ambika.
Hi. So I'd just like to share this paragraph, which echoes partly what Joseph said and what the other ideas that have arisen. I think Sri Aurobindo writes, "This then is the knowledge in which the liberated man has to do the works of sacrifice. It is a knowledge of the entire unity. It is the one manifest as the doer and the deed and the object of works, knower and knowledge and the object of knowledge. The universal energy into which the action is poured is the divine. The consecrated energy of the giving is the divine. Whatever is offered is only some form of the divine. The giver of the offering is the divine himself in man. The action, the work, the sacrifice is itself the divine in movement, in activity. The goal to be reached by sacrifice is the divine. And it is sad that when we are growing up, we get sort of irritated at certain rituals. And I think that's where in these times we have lost some of those connections or awareness of those, which feels really important to bring back. That everything is a ritual. Drinking a glass of water is a ritual. Brushing your teeth is a ritual. So that whole ritualized process becomes the action, which is the sacrifice, the work. And if we lived with that awareness, it would be really empowering. Just wanted to share that. Not what the New Age said, I'm God, you are God, but really it goes beyond that too. It's a sensibility too. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you. If possible, let's keep the discussion to the text. Because the application, what happens is that each person is making their own very deep application to their lives. So let people work with their own thing. So I would request that. What I want to do is I want to recommend a meetup to you, which is going to be probably one of the most profound meetups I have done so far. And that's going to be this Sunday at 10 a.m. Eastern time. It's going to be the passage that Ambika read out, which is a beautiful, beautiful passage, is by Sri Aurobindo. And he is very deep on this integration between the inner and the outer. Very, very profound thinker. You know, he's the most profoundest thinker that I have found in the Indian tradition in the 20th century. So, and what Savitri is, and I put the link there. And if you're not already part of 52 Living Ideas, please join 52 Living Ideas, because we do a lot more meetups than what are publicized in the Toronto group, for example. We do many more meetups, for example, this one right here. This Savitri, what it is Sri Aurobindo is trying to capture his entire philosophy and the entire Indian mind in a single story. This is a masterpiece. Just like Leonardo carried Mona Lisa and John the Baptist with him for decades and kept working on it, Sri Aurobindo worked on this Savitri, which is an epic poem, for over 30 years. And he kept on adding to it to capture all his philosophy. And we are going to have Nilesh Marik, who knows Aurobindo very well, who has studied Savitri in depth, to give us an overview of what this work is. Joe, if I could request you to put the Savitri video that we have on YouTube in preparation for this, I normally don't do this. I did a meetup just to prepare for this meetup, where I tell the story of Savitri from Mahabharata. Actually, the story from Mahabharata is far more deeper than how it is currently understood. And I begin to talk about how Sri Aurobindo approaches this story. So that's what I've done in the video. So I would recommend, you know, attending this meetup at 10 a.m. Eastern time Sunday, and watching the video that I did in preparation for it, so that you are familiar with the story. So we can, because I'm really eager to talk to Nilesh about this. So I'm going to try to do it go as deep as possible. So if you have watched this video, it will help you. Okay, wonderful. All right, so let's go. Who was next here? Let's see here. We will go ahead. Let's see how we are doing on time. 10:56. Let's do the last section on, we're going to just do the section on sacrifice, which is from going from 24 to 32. I want to do the introduction to it. Again, a very short paragraph by Sri Aurobindo. The title is The Significance of Sacrifice. The Gita now proceeds to give an elaborate explanation of the meaning of yajna, which is translated as sacrifice. But it, you know, again, these translations don't do justice to the meaning of some of the words. And this is definitely one of those words. But so try to understand what, you know, try to hear what they're saying, what Gita is saying, and try to come up with a word that matches better than sacrifice. The Gita now proceeds to give an elaborate explanation of the meaning of yajna, which leaves no doubt at all about the symbolic use of the words and the psychological character of the sacrifice enjoined by this teaching. So with that, Ambika, if you could read from 24 to 32.
Brahman is the giving. Brahman is the food offering. By Brahman is it offered into the Brahman fire. Brahman verily is that which is to be attained by one in samadhi of Brahman action. Some other yogins follow after the sacrifice, which is for the gods. Others offer the sacrifice by the sacrifice itself into the Brahman fire. Others offer their senses like hearing, etc., into the fires of control. Still others offer the objects of senses, sound, and the like into the fires of sense. And others offer all the actions of the sense and all the actions of the vital force into the fire of the yoga of self-control kindled by knowledge. Similarly, others are the sacrificers of their material goods, some others of their austere energy, and yet others of their yoga. Some strivers with keen and effective vows sacrifice their study and knowledge, and the others, devoted to pranayama, breath control, having restrained the movements of prana and apana, incoming and outgoing breath, put as oblation the prana in apana and likewise the apana in the prana. Still others, who are regulated and controlled in their diet, make an oblation of breath into breath. All these are knowers of sacrifice, cleansed of their impurities by yajna. Those who enjoy the nectar of immortality left over from the sacrifice attain to the eternal Brahman. This world is not for him who doeth not sacrifice. How then any other world, O best of the Kurus, Arjuna? Thus, the various forms of sacrifice are all extended in the mouth of Brahman, the mouth of that fire which receives all offerings. Know them all as born of karma, so knowing thou shalt become free.
Ambika, go ahead and read one more, 33 as well.
The sacrifice of knowledge, O Parantapa, is superior to material sacrifice. All work in its totality, O Partha, finds its culmination and completeness in knowledge.
Wonderful. Thank you. All right. Let's see. Doug, could you read your translation, the one that you like, of this part from 24 to 33? You need to unmute yourself.
You'll have to tell me when I've reached 32, 33.
Sure, I will do that.
I tried to find it. I'm not exactly sure. Brahman is the ritual. Brahman is the offering. Brahman is he who offers to the fire that is Brahman. If a man sees Brahman in every action, he will find Brahman. Some yogis merely worship the devas. Others are able, by the grace of the Atman, to meditate on the destiny of the Atman with Brahman. For these, the Atman is the offering, and Brahman the sacrificial fire into which it is offered. Some withdraw all their senses from contact with exterior sense objects. For these, hearing and other senses are the offering, and self-discipline the sacrificial fire. Others allow their minds and senses to wander unchecked and try to see Brahman within all exterior sense objects. For these, sound and the other sense objects are the offering, and sense enjoyment the sacrificial fire. Some renounce all the actions of the senses and all the functions of the vital force. For these, such actions and functions are the offering, and the practice of self-control is the sacrificial fire kindled by the knowledge of the Atman. Then there are others whose way of worship is to renounce sense objects and material possessions. Others set themselves austerities and spiritual disciplines. That is their way of worship. Other worship through the practice of Raja Yoga. Others who are earnest seekers for perfection and men of strict vows study and meditate on the truths of the scriptures. That is their way of worship. Others are intent on controlling the vital energy, so they practice breathing exercises, inhalation, exhalation, and the stoppage of the breath. Others mortify their flesh by fasting to weaken their sensual desires and thus achieve self-control. All these understand the meaning of sacrificial worship. Through worship, their sins are consumed away. They eat the food which has been blessed in the sacrifice. Thus they obtain immortality and reach eternal Brahman. He who does not worship God cannot be happy even in this world. What then can he expect from any other? All these and many other forms of worship are prescribed by the scriptures. All of them involve the doing of some kind of action. When you fully understand this, you will be made free in Brahman. Is that it?
That's good. Thanks. You know what? Do one more, please.
Oh, yeah. Okay. The form of worship which consists in contemplating Brahman is superior to ritualistic worship with material offerings. The reward of all action is to be found in enlightenment.
Wonderful. Thank you. So for
You're muted.
Yeah.
Thank you. If you would like to talk about what you got from this section, go ahead and type exclamation mark. You're welcome to read any of the verses that you found spoke to you. Go ahead and type exclamation mark or raise your hand in Zoom. Right. Anybody would like to share what they got? We'll start with Yogeshwar. Yogeshwar, go ahead.
Basically, the translation took great, actually. It was wonderful. And basically, one shloka that he read, one stanza that he read was, some actually get all their senses back and they discipline, they have self-discipline, and that's what takes them to the Brahma. And some leave their senses to go out and see Brahma in the world. So that translation was actually good. It shows the two types of people whereby one may actually do self-discipline and reach Brahma, and the other will see Brahma in the world and reach Brahma. And normally, if we talk about Indian philosophy and what is taken in Indian culture, mainly we see only one part, which is self-discipline is taken really, like they say, you must have self-discipline and that is what you have to do. And they're all the rules that you're supposed to follow in the culture. And that is actually a way of reaching Brahma if the rules are the, like, if they're the real rules, the truth. The rules should also be good, not rules that are superstitious or rules that are made up. So the rules should be from the scriptures. Rules should be from a person who has reached the enlightenment. And following those rules, you can actually reach enlightenment because he will give you the path on which you can reach enlightenment on. And basically, the taking of the breath in and out and really disciplining your breath, it also helps a lot. If basically, the whole thing actually lies on the last shloka that you made them read out as well, number 33. And that is the last part, but before that, yeah, before you reach Jnanyagya, everything brings a difference, whereby if your body is in balance, like even in the Western side right now, yoga, according to pranayama, is really going on well. And basically, in the Western side, yoga is only known as pranayama and asana. The other steps of yoga or samadhi and dhyana are not really known. Yeah. So pranayama actually brings a lot to the body. It brings discipline to the body. It actually brings peace to your mind. And that is really important in getting to Brahma. But then the last shloka, and I just got why you actually emphasize that shloka number 33 should be read, is all this karma yoga is good and it should be done. But if you know that jnana yoga is on top of karma yoga, or the jnana yagya is on top of the karma yagya, then you know and you should, and you will be revealed, you will be relieved from the karma yoga. So that is actually a really good point. So until then, karma yoga is really important, but there comes a point whereby you reach Atma, you have the enlightenment, and then everything drops off automatically. You don't need to drop it off. You are in the bliss itself.
Oh, Yogeshwar, that was so amazing. Thank you. I want to build on two points that you said. This point at the end, you know, people were asking the question about the changing and unchanging. Karma yoga is about the changing things. Jnana yoga is about kind of focusing on the core and understanding of the core and being able to be there. So that's one point. The second point that I really want to highlight of what you said was about rules. Rules, as is spoken of here, are like the Tao in Tao Te Ching. You're trying to get at the way in which nature works, this fundamental nature of how things are working. Unfortunately, no matter how profound the work is, there are people who are going to take the rules, and then the rules become primary, and they lose this connection with the living line. And that happens in religion after religion, as it becomes ritual and dissociated with the rules. So your point that the rules have to be the real rules, have to be actually capturing nature of reality. I thought that was profound. Thank you. Next up is going to be Doug, Joe, and Elena. Doug.
Well, I'm reminded of this section really begins to come back to me when I was studying this more carefully. And those approaches to literary criticism that deal with, I think Kenneth Burke does this, but the action, the actor, I think the object of action are the things that acted upon, and then even the field of action, which in this book is the battlefield that we're on. And there are various theories about the writing of plays, which I think this text in a way is a play, it's a dialogue. And so there is the action of, there are the emotions and the impulses and the thoughts and all of these different aspects of the psychology of who we are. But then how do you create a structure that actually deals with those things that work in the field of action and then may ultimately change the field of action? And that this wider awareness of the sacrificer, the one who makes the sacrifice is the actor. The sacrifice itself, which is the action, and then the field that is sort of consecrated for the battle or for the action. I think that, I'm not sure where that's heading right now. I'm avoiding going back into some of my past writings to try to deal with the text as it hits me right now. And so that those are just some things that pop up for me.
Thank you. Thank you, Doug. Again, another point that Yogeshwar meant, which I want to emphasize, is that there are many paths that, yeah, and all of them lead to yoga. So the yoga can be achieved through many paths. Some of them are very simple. Some of them are very complex. But all of them are paths. I think that that's a very profound point.
Yeah, and then actually it almost says in earlier on that I found it very interesting the first time I read the book, that no matter what path you're walking, you're gonna come to me.
Yes. You know, yes.
It's very interesting. It could be, yes, a good path or a bad path. You're gonna come to me at some point. But, you know, it is sort of like the Divine Comedy. You know, it's like, you're going to go down, but then you're going to go up at some point.
Thank you. Next up is going to be Joe, Elena, and Jen. Joe.
Yeah. My question was about 33, and I think everything that Yogeshwar actually answered, and you articulated it. So I'm good. I'm fine.
Wonderful. And I have to tell you, Joe, that 33 is like a culmination of the whole series. At the same time, it is the beginning of the rest. So it's like a fulcrum. Everything leads there and everything is going to lead from there. Next up is going to be Elena, followed by Cheng and Ambika. Elena.
Okay, so I'm going to the vase to do the sacrifice. So some do it through offering their senses and some offer their knowledge, and there are other ways. It seems to be two main passes and were described quite clearly. And then I want to bring a question here. How do you discern which path of sacrifice to choose, or just say controlling your breath or going into becoming creative?
Wonderful, excellent question. Thank you, Elena. We'll once we are done with all the comments, we will go to that question. It's a really crucial question. Next up is going to be Cheng and Ambika. Cheng.
Yeah, so I really like this chapter. Yeah, I didn't have a lot of time to join the discussion on Friday, but I think I actually just talked with my friend today, you know, about how sophisticated Indian spiritual development has, you know, so they have all different paths. Basically, instead of like, there's just one way you can go, because I think we all learn differently. We have different personality. 16 different persons. So some speak to someone to differently. So I just comment how sophisticated Indian spiritual development have been. So they're offered different way instead of Western, you know, Jesus the way. So it doesn't work for me. I can't really go anywhere. So I really like that. And I think this, another thing I want to share is about the past life, because I just met with the artist friend this afternoon, and she claimed she has past life and she actually have more connection intuitionally. So I found this quite interesting, you know, how this different culture, they're so similar in many ways, you know, how you connect, people connect with their intuition, so they can actually recognize some of their past life. And some, most of us don't. Yeah, I just want to make some comments on that.
Thank you. Thank you, Jing. Next up is going to be Ambika.
I just wanted to read these few lines that follow Shloka 33, which of course follows the other one, but that'll get too long. So he says, there are gradations in the range of these various forms of sacrifice. The physical offering, the lowest, the sacrifice of knowledge, the highest. Knowledge is that in which all this action culminates, not any lower knowledge, but the higher self-knowledge and God-knowledge. As the works grow more and more desireless, equal-minded, sacrificial in spirit, the knowledge increases. With the increase of the knowledge, the soul becomes firmer in the desireless, sacrificial equality of its works. The sacrifice of knowledge, says the Gita, therefore, is greater than any material sacrifice. I think which somebody already said, but this is really nice. They seem to all sort of cohere and then sort of spread like that in that sense. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Ambika. Folks, so now let's take that one question that Elena asks. When that is really unusual about the Indian approach. You know, you have the karma yoga, you have the jnana yoga, you have the bhakti yoga, you have the raja yoga. So in karma yoga, you're focused on work as a way of worship. On jnana yoga, you're focused on knowledge, understanding. In bhakti yoga, you're focused on devotion, just direct worship. In raja yoga, you're focused on training your attention on the core of being. And all these four are considered our paths to Krishna, to Brahma, to your Atma, which is all one thing. So how do you choose? What is the relationship between them? How do you choose? How does a person choose which path to take? And how are these related to each other? Yogeshwar, go ahead.
One thing first to understand that there is a description in psychology that some people are introverts and some are extroverts. So even in the Hindu scriptures, in the Indian scriptures, they have taken the type of person. They want to know which type of person you are, and then they show you the way you should attain Brahma. There are different types of ways because of the types of people they are. So you just know all of them in just a summary, and then there is something that will talk to you. Either like Jnana Yoga will be your way and Bhakti Yoga will be your way. Something will talk to you as you are engaging in them. So one thing that you have to do is you have to get into doing something. Either you start Jnana Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Karma Yoga, and then you will know that this is my way or this is not my way. And there is an essence whereby we cannot do only one thing our whole life. We can't only read our whole life. So we are going to have to do some karma, some bhakti, some jnana. Like, in a way I can explain is not like if you call somebody an introvert, he is not totally introvert, like he doesn't do anything externally. He is mostly introvert and there is only a small part of him that is extrovert. So even in this, you are mostly into one part and then the other parts will just help you a little bit. But the main part is only one. You cannot live like if I'm doing Jnana Yoga, I won't do any karma. So that doesn't happen. You have to do karma. And even bhakti will help there. And even Raja Yoga, like I said, the breath in and out, and even that will help you. Yeah. But there is something that will talk to you and something that will take you a leap ahead than the other ways. And that's how you know, because that's how you will know that this is my way. And without doing anything, you will not actually know whether this is my way or this is not my way.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Yogeshwar. Next up is Cheng, Joe, and Avanik. Cheng.
Yeah, I think the guy just answered my question. I actually have a question. If you have to, one way, or you can do combination. And I see, to me, the karma, the doing action, and the knowledge, and thinking deeply, you know, they all seem to talk to me. You know, I think those all can be my way. So that's really helping to understand it better. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Jing. Next up is Joe, followed by Avanik. Joe.
Yeah, it would be interesting to see how these two, you know, feed into one another. Because, I mean, if I'm understanding it correctly, and I think Yogeshwara has explained it properly, I mean, you know, clearly to me, that you just can't do one, right? There's not just one path. You have to just start out, and then you have to find your way. And that's kind of the way I'm viewing it. But I'm reading about all four now, and I believe there's got to be a relationship between all of them, that they're intertwined to one another. Is that incorrect?
Yeah, I mean, I think all of them, they deal with aspects of us human beings. So for example, you can map them into Jung's cognitive functions. The Bhakti Yoga is about feeling. Jnana Yoga is about thinking. The Karma Yoga is about the sensory, the actual physical action. And Raja Yoga is about training your intuition to be focused on where it needs to be focused. So it is different faculties that we have. And all of them actually work together. And actually, one of the things that is there, which is core part of this philosophy, is that there is respect for each of these. So a practitioner of Bhakti Yoga will have profound respect for the people who is a Karma Yogi, or for a person who is a Jnana Yogi or a Raja Yogi, and vice versa. So these are all respected. And you are trying, you know, if you are, you know, like in the last chapter, Krishna was saying, you know, though I know everything, I will still be a Karma Yogi. I will still do the action. And it's always that way. So they all kind of build on one another. But there are some things that are going to speak to you more than others, and that you're going to be able to develop better. Next up is Avanik.
Yeah, I was thinking of this as kind of levels, but now that I hear everyone else talking, I think I'm maybe a little bit off base. But I just saw it as levels, like knowledge, devotion, training, and attention on the core of being. But at the same time, even though there are different levels, there are different paths too. And you can choose which one, like you were saying, Srikant, that fits you best. And which one that goes with your personality. And so I think it is just kind of like, you know, feeling which one is, and you'll be at different levels at different times and at different stages of your life. So it's not like levels, like one is on top of the other, one is more important than the other, but it is like at different stages, you're going to be at different yogas in your life, and one may fit for a while and then another might fit better for this path or this time in your life. And I think it'll just go back and forth.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Evanique. So folks, two things. One is that we're going to take a break for 2 weeks because the next one, next Friday is Christmas Eve. And the Friday after that is New Year's Eve. So no meetups. So it'll be 3 weeks from today that we will do the next one. I encourage you to read kind of multiple translations. I also recommend the audio versions. You know, YouTube has many, many different audio versions, and they're very short. You can listen to the entire Bhagavad Gita in about 2 hours' time. And I recommend doing that because the way, at least for me, the way in which my mind works is that I learn by putting layers and layers. So you just let it flow over you multiple times, both in audio and then in writing. You will get some things from it that in the next iteration, you will get more. So I would recommend, both listening, you know, finding something that you like and listening, multiple translations. I really like the translation that Doug is using. And Doug, if you could put it in the chat, the name of the authors. It's because it is the poetry is tremendous. I also want to again recommend to you the Savitri meetup this Sunday at 10 a.m. Eastern time. That is going to be very profound. We're going to do it at the highest level we possibly can, the conversation, and then I will open it up for everybody. And I would recommend reading the story of Mahabharata, which is linked to in the meetup page, as well as watching the video, both of them. In order to do that, I'm going to put the, just putting the URL of the meetup here. So go ahead and sign up for that. And yeah, this is, so Doug's translation is by Christopher Isherwood and Swami Prabhavananda. Okay, wonderful. Thank you. Thank you so much. And special thanks to Yogeshwar. Yogeshwar, I mean, your comments were just profound. Thank you. Thank you for bringing so much to the table, James, Doug, and everybody else. So thank you so much. And we will see you soon.
Thank you.
Good night, everybody.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you.
Bye.
Have a good night.